On stage already, David Cuartielles, co-founder Arduino, special interest education, I don't say more. Clive Beale, not the founder of Raspberry Pi, but I've heard the first employee of Raspberry Pi, attention education. So here on stage we have two very successful European platforms for tinkering with hardware. Enjoy.
Hola, ¿qué hace? Hello. I could try to make this talk in Catalan, but not even the aboriginals would understand me. So I will try English. I am not native, as you might notice, which might make it very, very easy for the non-natives. I will be very clear. So Clive here and David here, we're going to talk about tinkering as education, not tinkering in education. And just for reference, this is how you write our family names. Take a good note of that, especially mine. Thank you. We'll try to keep this like very simple and funny all the way, as well as educational. I had almost forgot that, man. So we decided to make a part of our presentation as a common presentation. You know us, Arduino and Raspberry Pi, or to be fair, Raspberry Pi and Arduino. We are two different platforms, and as platform, we have to probably explain what we are talking about. So people look at us as boards. I mean, not us, but what we do as boards. And that's a very common mistake. That's what hardware companies do. We are probably not hardware companies. Besides, these guys are not even registered as a company. They're a foundation. Bastards. Sorry. We try to be a foundation, but at the time we were five people living in five different countries. I mean, how in hell can we had to get incorporated in three countries at the same time, just to make it easy. Anyway, what we do is basically people think that we are doing boards, but for real, everything that comes around the board is as important as the board itself. So we need to make software to program those boards, and we need to document how you can program those boards and how you can plug stuff to those boards and build stuff on top of them, right? And what that has brought to, I guess, both platforms here is a community of users that comes on top of everything, right? And I said community of users because it's very important. If we were just companies making devices, we will not talk about users, we'll talk about customers. And that's a very important distinction we have to make. We're not going to enter about, you know, how we sell stuff or how we get financed. In the end, it turns out that the Pis and the Duinos are financed in a very similar way. It's just a different kind of cartel. And I think the important thing is what people are doing and how people are tinkering and building things with our platforms. And that's why we're here today. In the end, we will even, like, you know, high five each other and hug each other and so on, for the picture.
Yeah, I thought initially York had got us up here and to see a bit of fisticuffs, and I'm sure it's quite the opposite at the end of the day.
So so you get a picture of the world distribution around the tinkering culture. This is taken from this is taken straight from Arduino's website statistics. People tend to think that everything happens in the US. Haha. This represents yellow is Europe, by the way. And Europe takes about 40% of the traffic in Arduino's website. And the US plus Mexico and Canada, in other words, the US, take 36%. I mean, I have Mexican relatives. I'm really sorry, but you know, when the internet works on pedals, then it's like, This is No. I'm trying to be ironic here, but this is a fact. I mean, this is based on internet statistics, is access to our web servers. Okay, so basically, Mexico and Canada, you know, the mooses don't really use computers yet in Canada, sorry. And then, but essentially, what we see here, jokes aside, is that there is a general interest in tinkering in both countries. And you might wonder, what is that big jump in there that happened in 2008? Well, Wired magazine wrote this article about tinkering, and they featured the Arduino board at the time, which, because it was probably the only successful tinkering platform that was on top of that open source. And funny enough, that provoked a reaction in the European press, and then Europeans got to know about the tinkering culture. So it's like, you know, European press looks at American press, and then that creates a reaction in the European tinkerers. I love that word, tinkerers. You have to
tinkerers
help.
Tinkers is good. We were also on Wired recently, I'd like to point out. I'm hoping for a similar jump.
Oh, yeah. Oh, I mean, this is beautiful. So what are people doing with electronics nowadays? Well, people are doing all sorts of stuff. They are trying to learn stuff. They make information systems, especially with those boards that have, like, you know, internet and stuff. They try to have fun. They build robots, and they make art installations. They make music instruments. They make wireless sensor networks, and you say it. You know, they do anything. That's one of the aspects of building a community and having open-ended tools. You never really know what's going to happen. And that's what we've seen in Arduino, for example, from the beginning, I guess. Clive is going to show you some examples as well. People are doing anything. You cannot really expect what's going to happen. So we have now a long list of examples and like a beautiful closing in the end. So I'm gonna you know, pass the mic to Clive. He was gonna talk about Raspberry Pi, and then I will talk about Arduino examples, and then we will hug each other.
Good.
Can you shift screens? Like, now it's the Mac, and then
it's the Pi book. I think.
Oh, sorry, it's the Pi book.
So I'm.
You're on that screen.
Briefly.
I think you're giving us the wrong screen. You're presenting on your screen, and you see the.
Can I get the
click on exchange?
Slider?
Click on exchange. I don't have a Mac, but I have a feeling.
That's okay. I'm giving this back at the end of this presentation. I was persuaded to take it on. Well, we'll have to make do with this odd setup, I guess. So I really want to talk briefly. I don't want to bore anybody with why we came into being, as David's already sort of filled you in about how we started. And we are all about education. We set up as an educational charity, and we made the Raspberry Pi. We made this little computer to get people back into computing. It's a long story. For those of you from UK will probably be familiar with it. We haven't taught it for 15 years in school. We've had this thing called ICT, which is great, but we need more computing, and so we built this thing. And we were really blown away by how many sold and where they've gone, what people are doing with them, and really underestimated what would happen when we put something like this on the market. So back in 1982, this is me probably. This is an advert from a UK national newspaper. And it's really non-ironic. It's selling the Spectrum as a very normal thing to have in a household, and a very normal thing for a child to use that to learn computing. And these fantastic guides you got with them, non-patronizing, this thick, wire-bound, full of assembler, full of code, full of wonderful things you could make. And, you know, we've lost all that, so we made the Pi. And, well, that's Infinite Lives in Manic Minor, for those of you who go back that far. But we became very comfortable as a coding nation, and now we're not, so we made the Raspberry Pi. So to us, it's really a tool set for tinkering and messing about and being creative and playing. It's a very general purpose computer. Whatever you've got in your head, you can pop out and you can do stuff with it. So it really is a multi-purpose tool set. We've seen what the sort of Arduino and the spikes there, and how many users around the world. These are Pis around the world. It's only about 30,000 of them. It's kind of self-selecting. because this is a thing called RazTrack. You can opt into it when you install the Pi for the first time. And you do see patterns there. You do see North America and Europe, but we're also spreading around the world and worldwide, and we're really interested at the moment in getting into developing countries as well. We've got a little composite connector there which can plug into old-style tellies, so you can just pop that in. It doesn't have to be high-tech, be very low-tech solutions. We deliberately don't patronize. I'm going to talk a bit more about that in the sense of scratch later. We boot with no, there's a tiny little icon at the top, but we don't overlay the boot up sequence. We want people to get involved from the start. So when they do get involved, well, what can they do? And the first thing most people do, or lots of people do, is make a media center, which is fine. And you get a reaction that says, well, the media center, isn't that kind of consumer based? Aren't you trying to make creators instead of consumers? Well, my answer to that is, if you set up that media center, at the very least, you'll have to see a Linux command line. You'll probably have to edit one or two configuration files just to get to play with that media center. So that's fine, but you can go a lot further. And this is Pi in space. This is looking over the UK down towards Cornwall, at about maybe 30, 40 kilometers. And you send a Pi in space with the camera attached on a balloon, a weather balloon, and it will send you back wonderful stuff like this. But not just photos, it will stream data back. You can take readings of pressure and so on. That was a professional one. It was by a chap called Dave Akerman, who's sends a lot of these things into space. This one's by a 13-year-old. It was a science fair experiment. And he decided that he was going to send marshmallows into space. And there's a little grape there as a control, because he wanted to see the marshmallows expanded as the pressure lessened. And it did, and he drew a wonderful graph, I don't have it here, of how that the marshmallows expanded as it went up and up and up. So it, again, doesn't have to be high tech. It's, you obviously need help with the helium balloon and getting permissions for that. But you stick a little computer onto a balloon and you send it up, and you can do amazing things at a very early age. And we talked a bit yesterday in the interfacing session about how it doesn't have to be technology. It can actually, you can actually get involved with quite low tech stuff. And at the bottom here, we got papier-mâché Martian landscape, and they're painting it, and they're making this is a group of scouts from the Aldershot scout group, and they're making a little rover. They learn to program, they use Scratch, they learn to program a bit in Python, I think, and then they program this rover to wander about the landscape, also using Arduino, the little robot as well. So you can really get this connection between the creativity and the technology. We're really passionate about that. This, again, this is by a couple of teenagers, and this is it's called AirPi, and it's got probably more sensors on a little board than I've ever seen in my life. It will read everything from nitrogen dioxide, carbon dioxide, humidity, temperature. And the cool thing about this is it will then send it back to a central server, and it will collect that data from all over the world, and you have that internet connectivity and the ability to get community data, to use large data and to analyze that data. And we like the sort of arty stuff. We want to get away from sitting under the stairs in the dark coding 5 hours a day. I'm very keen on this. We've just got an artist in residence on board. She's doing some fantastic stuff. This wasn't by her, but this is an installation down the London Docklands called Voyager. And if you tweet, it's controlled via Raspberry Pis, they're little plastic sort of origami boats. If you tweet to it, you can change the colours, and it will change and sweep through and so on. So again, this interactivity, this creativity. This is by Rachel Rains, our artist in residence, and this is called Zoe, and it's a plant feeder. And it monitors humidity, it monitors water levels, and inside the box is a Raspberry Pi. And what I really love about this, these little level sensors that look like cups on the front, they could have been LCD screens. That would have been quite easy to do, I guess. Well, what Rachel did was just connect them up to motors, and they're bits of MDF that move up and down. And we've got this whole sort of hacking sense, this Tim Hunkin, if you ever come across him, this invention. And this is the sort of thing that we're really keen on pushing, both in school and outside school. We like music. This is beatbox, and this is tap the beats and make music. And similar to Makey Makey, you know, turn anything into a button. This again is Raspberry Pi controlled. And what we're actually developing now is educational resources. So we've been running for about a year and a bit, but until we started to sell loads of the things, we couldn't actually afford to go and do our educational stuff, which is what we're about. So I came on board in February. So we've been doing that for 4 or 5 months. And this year, our real push is education, to support teachers, to support schools, to support kids who want to use the Raspberry Pi to learn, to create, and to do stuff. And this is a set of lesson resources and plans called Sonic Pi. And this basically allows you to learn programming through making your own synthesizer on the Raspberry Pi. And we're going to do a lot more of this. We're going to do a lot more training and really supporting teachers this year. I'm not too far from finishing. But David's going to show you some fantastic bits of research. And all I can say is we're really interested in this. It's brilliant. And if 2 years down the road, we're sort of at that stage where we're doing things in school and collecting data, we would be delighted. I'm going to see some more of that in a minute. We've got this little hook in Minecraft, and we talked again about this yesterday. There's a version of Minecraft, and we can program it. So, well, how does it relate to tinkering? Well, I've started to play about with making things outside Minecraft, which can control things in the game. So a big plunger, if you press it, connected with curly wires, and it will blow stuff up in the game. Or as you move through the game, you can make things happen in Twitter. You can tweet as you get nearer to something, or a little LED will flash. So again, we got this connectivity, and I've just found when I've run that with kids, it's just, even with people who don't like Minecraft, just the creativity and the fact that you've got this two-way communication and this tinkering is just a brilliant, brilliant learning process. I talked about this clock yesterday, so I would like to teach maths by stealth. I would like to get Minecraft into every maths lesson in the world, because to know where those hands are, this is a real-time clock, it ticks around, you need trigonometry, you need to work out where it's going to point, you need angles, and you need sines and cosines. And there's other things like Pythagoras for hide and seek and stuff. There's one chap, we are going to be releasing stuff. There's a chap that's been working on a fantastic set of resources, and we will be releasing some Minecraft stuff. We talked about robots. I could not have a picture of a robot. We did robots yesterday. There's a Raspberry Pi on top of a robot. And probably coming towards the end now is a bar, which is Raspberry Pi controlled. And close to the hearts of ourselves at Raspberry Pi, completely non-educational in that sense, but I felt that we should see that there are more important uses to the Pi. And we were at a Scratch conference, an educational conference, and of course, the Raspberry Pi comes pre-installed with Scratch. We've got someone working on it specifically to improve it. We're nearly there. It runs pretty smoothly now. If you haven't updated the latest image, you'd be quite surprised, I think, by how smooth it's running. And of course, just as we're getting towards optimizing it fully, a new one was released. So close. But of course, we're really pleased now that there will be a standalone one coming out, and obviously we're going to have a look at that and see if we're getting it running. Very important for us to be on the standard image for Raspberry Pi. In fact, my ideal would be to have a little plastic yellow box with a cat on, maybe, but that you could just buy and plug into your telly, and for £30 or so, it would boot straight into Scratch, and you could just be programming, you know, within 30 seconds of plugging that in, straight into a little environment where you can play and explore and do stuff. I'd like to see that, actually. This one actually is a connection to a remote control car. You can see on the next slide. You can connect the pins to the Raspberry Pi. These are not an accident, our little general purpose input out pins on the Pi. We put them there because we want people to tinker. And you can connect them straight into a cheap remote control, and you can then program your little car for about £8. You can program that through Scratch. You can get it to go around mazes, have little races. And I've run that in the classroom, and it is a fantastic thing to play with. This is a Scratch-run project by a 7-year-old chap called Oliver, and it's called B-Box. It has a little magnet in this B, and then there's read switches in this box. And as you move the bee around, it sort of buzzes. And on screen, his sister helped them with the Scratch on screen version. And it actually shows what the bee's doing on screen. It actually follows its path. So again, this interaction between real world and what's going on screen, very, very powerful pedagogically and conceptually. And I thought also it was just a fantastic thing. It's a bee with the buzz around on an old index file. And of course, the last thing you can do is team up with a board called Arduino and do fantastic things. There are a lot of things going on there which require or benefit from both. And I think Davi is now going to tell you a bit more about projects that have been running on that. Thank you.
Okay.
It's like a bat, it's like a rat back.
Yeah. Hola, hola. I think I lost my voice. All right, let's talk about Arduino. So, can you actually hear me through a microphone? Okay, suddenly I don't hear myself, which is probably good. So, many people just think that Arduino is a single board like this one. Arduino really, I mean, this is the first board that became successful, but we look at our project as a platform where there is many different devices, and we look at the possibility of probably just running on almost everything. Because what we are working with is with a different kind of abstraction for writing software for embedded computing. And I know this sounds like a super complicated sentence. So I'm going to show you a couple of examples. Just to keep it simple for you, what we're trying to make is to answer complex questions about computing paradigms. It's like point number 4 on this slide. Right? This means, you know, in a science lab, we talk about palpable computing or physical computing or ubiquitous computing, but just go and tell a kid about ubiquitous computing and look at his or her face. Right? So we try to make that real, and we try to explain people those concepts in a way as easy as possible. So this is one of the first Arduino projects ever made back in 2005. So I'm going to give you a history lesson. In this project, Melvin Oxman, who was one of my students at Malmo University College, where I work at, was trying, he's an architecture student, by the way. He happened to knock my door one day, and he never left. Or he left once he graduated. I mean, but it was hard to kick him out. He was German, you know Germans. And so basically what he was trying to do was to cross the census. He had a very abstract idea. By the way, I forgot to tell you, I work at an art school. I don't work at an engineering school, so that's a given. So he was trying to cross the census, the eyesight with the hearing and the distance to objects, the feeling of presence of objects with visuals and so on. So he built this helmet. It took him like more or less a day to build his first helmet, as you see here. And then with a bit more of work, he built this other helmet that travel around the world, was present at Ars Electronica 2006. So we got a pretty confused architecture student, and he went from, okay, I have no idea about electronics, to present his piece at the most prestigious electronics art festival in the world with over 30 years experience in 6 weeks' time. And basically that's our process, right? We try to make things that simple so that people can create, they can build, they can be expressive with technology in an easy way. Sebastian, on the other hand, he was 14 when he first connected an earthquake detector to the internet and made the machine tweet messages. Now he has his own company. This is like 2 years ago, by the way. He has his own company where people can download an application in Chile and be informed about different earthquake maps in the region. He won an award that year for the best Internet of Things project. Again, Sebastian is not the average kid. He's wearing a Debian t-shirt. For those of you that are not familiar to Linux, Debian is probably the hardest of the hardcore operating systems, you know. But he's 14. I think that says quite a lot. So when it comes to where Arduino has been used, one of probably the most prominent examples is when the Fukushima disaster happened. In Japan, there was public opinion were not satisfied with the information they were getting from government officials. So people started to look for alternative ways to monitor radiation in the different cities. So there was a global movement trying to create radiation monitors, and people were building their own radiation monitors based on Arduino, like this one here, and decided to plug them to the internet and create radiation maps so people could know what was going on in places close to them. Again, this is not scientific measures. You know, it's like The value that it says there probably shouldn't be taken completely seriously, but if you saw a red value close to you, you should probably get worried. That's again, an important aspect. Then within Arduino, we do really crazy stuff sometimes. I mean, Arduino is a company, as I said. We run about 50 projects in parallel people don't know about. And one of the strangest projects that happened this summer was that Sony knocked our door and said, you know, we would like our smartwatches to be programmed with Arduino. And we said, like, sure, we can do that. There you go. So you get the idea. This is a small computer with a touchscreen, a buzzer, a Bluetooth connection, and a whole lot of different things. It costs about 80 euros. You know, it wouldn't be very expensive to get a whole class, for example, running on this watch and do a lot of wearable computing experiments. So it's possible to take this abstraction because basically everything we do is open source and then just migrate to different platforms. In this case, it took us exactly 48 hours to people to get this done. You know, this is the idea. And then you can do things like this, right? Like turn on the screen and, you know, start programming. This is a hacked version of the Arduino software to reprogram Sony smartwatches. So throw me a watch. I will reprogram it for you.
Analog one.
Yeah, well, that's, give me the USB. And then there's other projects that we do, like extremely boring research projects. I mean, I shouldn't say this, if maybe the government, the EU official is in this room and he will throw tomatoes to me. But we work a lot with the idea of connected devices. And in this particular project, we are trying to look at how can you make a connected home, like for real. But what is the advantage of having your fridge connected to the internet? I don't want my fridge to tell me I'm running out of milk. That's a pretty stupid idea, by the way. If you're dreaming, if that makes you get wet, then, you know, don't talk to me. But I think it's much more important to look at important social aspects. Like, for example, 40% of the students, university students in Sweden, are considered homeless because they have to change apartment every fourth month. Right? So they will never make their home appliances because they have to change so often. But if they could just carry their personal profile with them to the next apartment, for example, that would make their life much easier. So this project looks into that, how to build social networks where you can upload your personal profile of preferences and that will migrate from place to place. So what Arduino is doing is looking at washing machines, dishwashers and stuff, and how to make them, you know, connected to the internet. Like, for example, you know, hooking a coffee machine or, you know. This is probably the engineering stupid dream. Everybody wants to have a connected coffee machine. People tend to forget that you still need to put the powder and the water in the machine. But this is basically a proof of concept. I don't know if you know this, but the first webcam was created to monitor a coffee machine in the lab, right? So as a joke, this year we just connected our coffee machine in the lab to the internet. So we put like 150 euros of equipment to connect a 40 euros coffee machine. Clever. But it works. And but okay, we've seen a lot of robots here, and I would like to make a point because there was a discussion yesterday in one of the panels about how important it is to build your own robots from scratch, right? And I mean, to me, that's almost like how important it is to build your own computer from scratch. You know, just go to the beach, take the sand, and then make your own microchips, you know? I mean, we in society, we're building tools, and then sometimes the tools are already made. You don't need to make your own pencil to start writing. So in my opinion, to learn some basic aspects about robotics, you can just as well start with a pre-made robot. And then once you get interested, if you want to go more in depth into a topic, you might as well build your own robot. And in Arduino, we've seen a lot of robots. This is the first robot ever hacked in Arduino, and it's a multipede. I don't know how you say that in English, really, multipede, millipede, whatever. It's complicated, this language.
Has legs.
It's beautiful. And so this is, but the story behind this is very powerful, I think. When we first made Arduino in 2005, we just had a picture on a website of a hand holding a board like this that has become kind of a standard how to show electronics. And it said, guys, this is open source, just make it yourself. And the guy from China said, where can I buy this board? And we were like, look, we made 300 boards. This is open source, make your own board. And he asked, how can I make my own board? I said, look, here's the file, you etch it with acid. I explained him the whole process in an email. I will never, don't send me an email like that because I don't have the time now, but back in 2005, I took my time to answer step by step how you actually etch a circuit. It's like a day later, this guy, straight from nowhere, sends me a picture. Look, I made my board, I programmed my board, it's working. And I said, okay, now I'm gonna send you like the official circuit, right? So I took one of the circuits that I had from my university and I packaged it and I took components and I packaged it and I sent them to China. It took like a month to arrive to China. I know it's very weird. You just take components, probably manufacture in China and ship them back to China in normal post. But I did that as an experience and it worked, you know. And so this guy sent me, as a payback, he sends me these pictures and this video of his robot moving and it was this thing. And the most amazing thing, he was controlling this thing from a compact iPad. I don't know if you know those handheld computers. So he even added a Bluetooth chip and programmed everything. And then I asked him about his story. Well, this was a second year mechanical engineering student at a Chinese university, and his professors were asking him to program an 8051. I see a lot of white hair in the room, so you guys know what an 8051 is. And for those that don't know, don't bother, you know, it's like, but this guy basically, he said, I need something that I can program myself. And at that point, I think is when we understood that we need to make things that people could actually teach themselves instead of having to be taught by anybody. We understood that we didn't have the power because we were basically five people in five different countries in 2005. And we understood that people had to be able of learning by themselves. We couldn't be the ones teaching them. Okay, but from this robot, we've seen a lot of them. This is a robot made by a high school teacher in Spain. He has a minimal budget. In Spain, the average school has about 300 euros a year to spend in materials. And you might recognize the ball because you see it every morning very close to your armpit. This one. Where is the mouse? Okay, there is no mouse. Oh, there is this one. That's it from the roll-on from the deodorant. But the total expenses in this robot, I think this robot was made for about 40 euros in total, everything included. And so in his class, he could have 10 robots made up of recycled parts. So that inspired me to make this robot. And I was working in Mexico at a place called Faro de Oriente. And Faro de Oriente is a alternative education center that is located in the city center of Mexico, and they have one of the computer clubhouse villages there. And the kids, I told the kids about building music instruments, and I asked them at the end of the first month I was residing there. I was there for 2 years. So, guys, what do you want to do next? And they told me, we want to make robots. And I was like, no, I don't make robots. You know, I was like, I'm really not interested in robots. There is many more things you can do with electronics. We can do wearable computing things. We can, you know, design something for your home. And the kids, we want to make robots. And it's like, you don't fight 20 angry Mexican kids. As a matter of fact, you don't fight 20 angry anything, you know, but. So I started trying to build or find how to get a robot done in Mexico. And my mission was really to make a robot out of pieces that could be found in Mexico. Because one of the big problems in Latin America is that components don't make it to the place. You know, it's like, for example, in Arduino, we use a chip called Atimega 328. Well, go find an Atimega 328 in Mexico. And it's a 90 million inhabitants country. You know, you can find the Atimega 8, which is like three generations back. Well, that's what I did. So I went out, found every part in the market, designed a robot that they could actually replicate. And now they have 20 or 30 of these, and they're actually making more robots for other people. And it was like about 45 euros, something like that, in cost. So when I published my results, these two kids in the picture, they're not kids anymore, right? But they were kids back then. They called me and said, you know, we are 3 times world champions in robotic soccer. We are from Madrid. And I was like, wow, I didn't even know robotic soccer existed back then. And we'd like to make a robot with you. And I was like, sure. They started to talk about making robots. At that point, I had already given up. You know, this kind of, I don't make robots too. Okay, let's see what we can do. Well, these guys are like the Formula One of robotics, right? When they build a robot, they need 3,000 or 4,000 euros in parts. And they spend a full year in an after-school program, 3 days a week, 3 or 4 hours every session, building their own robots and teaching younger kids how to build their own robots. And yeah, but in Arduino, we don't work in that way. We work in trying to give people a really easy entrance to a subject. So I spent 2 years sitting with them, redesigning their basic competition robot to be affordable and to give you a really easy way into robotics, which is this, that actually was launched just like a month ago. So this basically condensates about 8 years of knowledge from these two kids, who are now 19 and 17, and are already university students. And it's basically a robotics platform that allows you getting started very quickly in robotics. It's not very different from many others that exist already there. The big difference is this one is 100% open source. And it's co-designed with two teenagers, by the way, which is quite a mission. Then, since we are at the Scratch conference, I just want to show you quickly one of the projects that will never see the light, because we believe that Scratch should be making Scratch and Arduino should be making Arduino boards and Arduino documentation. But we tried open blocks as a way to create Arduino code. So you can, if you're interested, you can probably download our implementation of this. And we understood very soon that one of the big problems we found is that in Arduino people build a lot of stuff. And if you need to rely on like the very basic aspects like turning on a light or turning on a pin or turning off a pin, and you need to write a library for example, controlling a GPS, you know, it gets very complicated. So we needed people to be able to write their own blocks. So we even created a tool for people to create their own blocks and add them to the system and so on. But the biggest problem that we found, Anna, is that when people think about embedded, when they build very simple things with a piece of electronics, they have a keyboard, and when they press a button, they want something to happen and so on, they think event-based. You know, they think when this happens, then this happens, right? But Arduino doesn't work like that. Arduino is based on going through every pin, every time. It's a polling system, right? So this paradigm doesn't work for us. Doesn't work to write the low-level code. So we tried different, you know, icon designs trying to explain what you are actually doing with physical parts and so on, trying to make it easier to understand. And if you guys at Scratch are interested, we could sit down for some hours and discuss about this. And I'm really happy to hand over our icon set. If you implement it, I will be really happy and I will hug you every day. Because our goal is this, right? We want to get state-of-the-art technology to be used in the classroom. I think what we see is that many times schools, they buy stuff and it gets old before it can even be used because the teachers don't have the time to get trained in how to use it. We really want schools to get the latest and use the latest and get the latest pedagogical resources and so on. No? And if suddenly Sony smartwatches get important in class, why not, you know, buying 10 Sony smartwatches, right? So we just try to make it easy for that to happen. And probably if we are lucky, we'll get Sony to pay for that as well. But that's a different story. So this is the ideal scenario. It's like, it would be great if Batman asked Robin and Robin told Batman, you know, I learned this at school. Unfortunately, this is not really what is happening, right? But I think that we are all here because we want to change this. And I think it's important, and I think in both projects, Raspberry Pi and Arduino, we believe in public education. By the way, I have to show my supporting Spanish education t-shirt. So I want to show you my research in this field. And this is the project we discussed about briefly, and it's a project about creating curriculum for schools. And I think this is really the complicated task, because curriculum is different in every country, and even in Spain there are 17 regions, even each region has its own competence in how curriculum should be written. I don't know if you know this issue, for example, with Lego Mindstorms in Spain. It's like they cannot really be sold as an educational resource because it needs to be translated to every regional language. Like it needs to be translated to Catalan, Gallego, you know, now La Pau, which is the language in my region. I can tell you a story later that will make you cry. Okay, but this project in the Castilla region that we did, the idea was to go into 25 schools and help the teachers to run this class. You know, there is no way you can pay for a research project where you're going to have like 25 researchers going into 25 schools at the same time. And so you need a different strategy to get this to happen, at least in Europe at this point. And so I asked the teachers personally, do you have any experience programming? And 70% said, yeah, sure.
We were talking about this the other day, and I thought this is really, really high, because in the UK it's probably 1 in 20 based on research, maybe less.
And then I explained, Clive, like, you know what, this is actually 25 handpicked teachers from a group of 40,000. So yeah, sure. Then I asked this other question. Do you program in your spare time? Because, you know, we're talking about having a passion for technology here. I always take the math teacher. Usually math teachers are mathematicians, not always, but, you know, usually people study math because they have a passion for math. Not always, but most of the times. But unfortunately, tech teachers, they end up there because they learned biology and they were assigned by the head of school to teach that class. And that's very tragic. And this is what happens. You know, many people don't have a passion for this. And I asked a very simple question. I didn't ask them, do you build robots or flying objects? I asked, do you program? Which is a very basic thing. And only 20% of these 25 handpicked teachers out of 40,000 said yes. So then I asked them, have you introduced any programming concepts or any programming languages in this class before we start this experiment? And 50% said yes. I didn't ask them what, but they said yes. Then I asked the students, what are you? And this is about gender distribution. And 40% of these people were girls. And I have to say, this class is not a compulsory class. This is the class that you take in the fourth grade of ESO in Spain, which is like when people decide whether they're going to go science or they're going to go humanistics and so on. So let's say 40% of these people were girls. So summary, there is 24 schools, over 500 kids, and the way we run this thing is based on my 13 years experience in teaching at the university, where I take a 10 weeks period, and I use the first weeks in making very quick iterations, design iterations with my students. Like the first week I teach them digital input outputs, and I tell them to design something with just lamps and buttons. Create a game with just lamps and buttons. Think about the logics in this game. And then the second week I teach them analog inputs, and I teach them to design something that plays as music. And then the third week I teach them about movement, motors, accelerometers, more complex stuff, and I ask them to build a machine, whatever machine. Well, we took that and translated to high schools. There is just one difference. At university, you have 3-hour long sessions, 3, 4, 5 times a week. At high school, you have 45-minute sessions, and if you're lucky, it's 3 times a week. So the cool thing in this experiment is that I managed to get this in the official curriculum in the class. This was not an after-school program. Actually, one of the schools of the 24 ran it as an after-school class, but the other 23, they made it as a normal curriculum. It takes a lot of lobby to get that done, by the way. I had to drink a lot of coffee. So the first 4 weeks, we did these quick iterations. I call them the emulation weeks, where the students, they had to do pre-made experiments. And then the following 9 weeks, and it's 9 weeks because in Spain, Easter is 2 weeks, and it happened to come in the way of the project, so it couldn't be exactly 10 weeks, so it had to be a bit longer. The kids got a project to build, and they decided the project, and this is a very important thing. In the beginning, we thought we were going to give them a task, but then in the process, they became so empowered that they decided their own projects. And I know this is one of the biggest problems that teachers have, is to get the kids to design for their own project. So, and then we finished with a closing event where there were 80 projects presented. So from these 500 kids, only 400 could make it because Castilla, the region we made the experiment, is fairly big. It's as big as Ireland. So some kids had to travel 300 kilometers to present their project. So that it was not completely feasible for everybody. But we got 80 projects to be presented, which means 400 kids. And what we did was to prepare their experiments really well. It was based on the idea of critique. The first day in the week, the teacher was introducing a concept like digital input-output, but he didn't call it digital input-output, or he didn't call it analog input-output, he called it the week of magic. And in the week of magic, they learn about capacitive sensing, for example. And these are all experiments that have to do with capacitive sensing. This is a so-called tickle robot, and when you tickle this robot on the chest, that is a basically a touch sensor made of aluminium folia, it lifts the legs. Well, we created this, we prepare the robot times five, because every class got five different experiments, times 24 schools, and we ship them to Spain. And that times 4 weeks. So yes, you can make the math, four times five times 24 times whatever, a lot. So we basically did in parallel five experiments in 24 schools at the same time for 4 weeks. And the last day in the week, the class would make a critique session. This is actually a really new thing. I didn't allow the teachers to make exams of any kind. They had to make a critique sessions. The kids had to present their project and share what they had learned with the others. And the teachers were not really used to this process either. So this is an example of that tickle robot. All the parts, this is made on a laser cutter. And we basically ship this to everybody, and the files remain. It's like everything we did in the project was open. All the files are available. You can download the PDFs. You can get the original source files. You can do everything yourself and reappropriate it and change it. This is the most successful experiment, by the way, was this one. It's called Cookie Monster. And it's, again, based on the capacitive sensing. And it's a cookie monster that has a camera in the head. And when you try to grab the cookie jar, it takes a picture of you. And this project is the product of a five-year-old brain. My daughter realized that somebody was eating her cookies at night. And she asked me to help her design something that would catch this person. And turns out this was the most successful project among all the projects we did. For some reason, the high school students, they really loved the idea of secrecy, and they wanted to keep their stuff protected. So every week we asked them, okay, which project did you do, and how far did you go? And you see there's three answers. Green means the project failed, I couldn't finish. Blue means it worked as I expected it to work, and orange means I improved the project. And we can see how the amount of projects improved increases week after week. So the first week, very little projects were improved by the students. The second week, more or less half the projects were improved. And the last week, almost all the projects were improved by the students. We also were reducing the complexity, so they had more space to actually improve the projects. And you see that the boombox example is very green, which means it failed a lot. Actually, that was our test. That was meant to fail. It was designed to fail. And I'm actually surprised that some people got it done. I still don't know how they did it, but because it was designed to be not working. But the cool thing is that even though it didn't work, the students were forced into making a new project and a new project and a new project every week, what meant that if a project failed, they didn't give so much importance to it. And you know, tinkering is about trying and failing and trying again and see what you learn when you try, right? If you just have one single project and you fail dramatically, then you don't get a chance to, you know, rebuild your self-confidence. I see the Cookie Monster, most successful. Big kudos to my daughter. So I asked the kids as well things like, without really caring how far you made it, would you learn more about programming? Yes. I will read you the qualitative answer, because I had a qualitative answer, but you know, I have 300 qualitative answers to that question, so I will spare you the time. And in general, I ask the kids every week, do you like the class, the technology class? And we got a very consistent 89 to 91%, which means that those that were kind of forced to take the class in the first place, they didn't like it all anyway, you know. But the rest, they really got hooked into it, and they worked to make it happen. Funny enough, I realized that the no's were coming mostly from the same school, which means that teacher wasn't that good. And this is actually the result. This is the last 9 weeks when people were, the way I work is that every week I had a call with the teachers every Monday to discuss about the task they were going to be building and to discuss about the complexity of the project, what they could find complicated, what I thought before they went into it could be a problem. And then during the last 9 weeks, I was supposed to give support to build the projects, but suddenly there was a silence in the line. You know, I got like almost no communication with the teachers, and I thought, damn, this is gonna fail dramatically, right? It's like, this experiment is gonna be a disaster. Turns out, they were so busy working, they had no time to get online. It's like, students were going after school to class and work until 8 p.m, and parents were calling in asking, where is my kid? Is it true he is at school? You know, and yeah, the teachers were like, yeah, sure. So when I made it to the final presentation, the 22nd of May, I didn't expect to see anybody, and there were 400 kids with 80 projects to present their stuff, right? And this is a picture we took. Actually, I broke the protocol. This was a beautiful moment where I had the president, or the equivalent to the president of education in the region of Castilla-La Mancha, was standing here. And at some point, I took my smartphone and said, do you mind taking a picture of us? Because I would love to have a Twitter image of this, all these kids. And he was like so surprised. He actually took the picture. And then he actually asked his assistant to take the picture. And he came down with us. And he kneeled down. And that was completely against protocol. But you know, politicians like to be in the picture. So yeah. So it was a really beautiful moment. I mean, I didn't expect this to happen. You know, after 13 weeks of work, suddenly it really paid off. And there is a lot of small stories, and I love one in particular where this kid, he built a full dance mat, you know, like a PlayStation dance mat, and a processing program that was playing the music and was giving you indications you have to press left, right, both left and right at the same time and stuff like that. And he was a bit of a, you know, fatty guy, and he had a queue of girls to come and dance on his dance mat. And he came to me and said, like, you know, I never expected to be flirting because of being able of programming. And I was like, you know what, me neither, but good for you. And so I think, you know, this kind of experience really opens up for much more than just, you know, learning. It teaches you about what might be important. Not that girls are important. I mean, of course they are.
So out of your 400 kids, did you still have 40% girls?
40% girls in those 400. Yeah.
Still stayed high?
Yeah, totally. I mean, the statistics I was running every week, I was asking every week how many girls.
May I ask to do the Q&A in the coffee break, because you have a very interesting story, but it takes a little time, and we also want Clive.
And we have Clive. So, yeah. Sorry.
And we will shorten the coffee break.
Yeah. So yes, more later. So I forgot to tell you that, I didn't forget, but everything that we did in this project, like everything we do is open, right? It's like every single file in that project generated the statistics you've seen. I'm working on compiling everything. It's going to be available, but the files will be available as LibreOffice documents. So if you need to recreate this class by yourself, you get all the text. I hope you guys like Scribus, because if you need to lay out the documents, you have to use Scribus, no InDesign. Sorry for Adobe users. And so on. So everything that you see in these presentations is actually open source. The circuits, everything. So that was us, and I think you have a video.
Yeah, we've been chatting about this, and I've been thinking about this as well, and the curriculum's massively important, and it's something we're really engaged in, the foundation really wants to support. But I also think I wanted just to make a point from a personal point of view and an individual point of view, because you've got schools, you've got the curriculum, we're educators. This, if I can have my screen up, please. I just want to show you a quick video, really quick, 1 minute or something, of a six-year-old who was given a Raspberry Pi with scratch on. And just his experiences of that, and it's a 1 minute video just really chatting about what happens when.
We need to shift video, right? Other computer. Shift video. Yeah, there you go.
Oh, fantastic. So it's not gonna run, is it? This Well, can you run out, actually run out on yours?
Yeah, good running of mine. Okay,
we've got a contingency plan, so we've got a proper machine that will actually run this thing. And it's what happens when you actually give the tools and the support and the wherewithal to an individual to create and to tinker and mess about. And David will get this up now, I'm sure. The sound for the first sort of 30 seconds is a bit...
Well, I need the audio cable. Do you have the audio cable? Okay. Yeah, I will hold the microphone.
It sounds muddy for the first bit, and then it clears up. I have subtitled some of the keywords on the screen, not in anticipation.
No, we want to hear this thing, so please, the technique, we want video with sound, and until you finished, I do another service announcement. After the coffee break, there are two workshops on the program. Workshop 1 is in room A, and workshop 2 is in room B. They switched. So if you're looking for Raspberry Pi workshop by Clive, don't go up, but stay down.
Workshop is actually where we'll, with one little block of scratch, we will flash an LED on and off and switch a pin on and off. It is that simple.
Yes, but it will be in the other room, as published. And I also, during this presentation, just after David made his remarks about, is anybody of you present, but just after, you are Alexa Joyce?
Yes.
She arrived, and... we worked for half a year to get European Commission aboard. Nelly Cruz has big problems with digital, with her digital agenda. We think we have an almost free solution, but somewhere we don't connect. We're very happy to have European Schoolnet this afternoon with a presentation in Butterfly. Do we have sound? Well, we try the third computer.
Could you copy that onto yours? Hmm.
What was this about failing and trying again?
Will we get sound? Will you get sound?
Yes, I have sound.
So we got the same video running on three screens now?
Five! Okay, I'll play my video.
Do something, move 10 steps, hide, switched to costume, pop and hide. The slider is my best thing because you can turn the volume up and down, and you can say when you press the sensor button something happens, broadcast something, and if you speak in the speaker, change size by loudness, and if loudness is better than 180, do something.
Do you like the screaming jelly baby?
Yes.
Right, thanks, Rachel. I won't really commute you coffee for more than another minute. It just so happens that was to be my son. And of course then people are sitting around thinking, oh, ICT dad had him under the stairs. Before, you're not coming out until you learn recursion and stuff like this. But actually I showed Stan Scratch when he was six and he just didn't want to know. And then a year later I came back and he was making these games. And I was quite amazed. I said, how did you do this? And it turned out that he'd been going to his nan's once a week, his grandma's, once a week for on Wednesday, and she'd let him onto YouTube, and he'd sort of looked at all these things on YouTube, and he taught himself Scratch from YouTube. And all I wanted to do is to make the point that we shouldn't patronise young people. We don't let them have the flexibility and the tools and the freedom to play, and it's things like Scratch that give them that opportunity and give them those tools and support to go off and do amazing things at a very early age, and they will always, always surprise you. And I was surprised, also very proud, of course. But Scratch is just such a fabulous learning tool, and that's why I'm here today, and that's why we have it on the Raspberry Pi pre-installed.
Thank you, Clive.
Thank you.
Or?
Sorry, yes, thank you. How British and Spanish people hug.